Alliance here. We're talking about Geraldine Fitzgerald, right?
Yes.
And the fabulous Jimmy Coco.
Hi.
They're here because of a new motion picture. It's being filmed on the streets of New York. And what is it being called? What's the name of your new picture?
Bye Bye Monkey.
Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you right after this timeout with Marcello Mastroianni and James Coco, Geraldine Fitzgerald, and Gerard Depardieu. This morning, ladies and gentlemen, some old pals here. Marcello Mastroianni is here, along with Jimmy Coco, Geraldine Fitzgerald, and comme vous dites, Gerard Depardieu. Do I have it right? Yeah. Marcello, I want to tell you a story. I had lunch with Marcello last Sunday, and Jimmy and Geraldine were not there, nor was Gerard. Incidentally, they're filming a motion picture in New York. And about 5 years ago, I was going with a wonderful gal named Patricia. And we were living up in Wisconsin, and she was very faithful to me, but she said there's only one man I would not be faithful for, and that was Marcello Mastroianni. And I had seen you in motion pictures like The Organizer and Divorce Italian Style, and I said to her, I said, you know, I understand. I really do. I love the guy, too. And I just wanted you to know that you made an impression on all of us. There's only been two men, I suppose, I ever wanted to be in my life. One was Robert Capa. Do you know who Robert Capa was?
Yes, I did.
Who was he?
Great, great photographer.
He was the greatest photojournalist of our time, or one of them. He was the man who took that great picture during the Spanish Civil War of the Legionnaire shot in the moment of death.
Yes.
And he was on Normandy, and he was killed in Vietnam. And there was something about him, based upon his work and the pictures that I saw of him, I said, that is the man I wanted to be. The other one was Marcello Mastroianni. And I'm not going to be either one of them. I'm going to have to settle for being Stanley Siegel. But one of the reasons we like Marcello so much is that I guess he symbolizes the loveless, faithless, rudderless, spiritually anesthetized, and immobilized people of our time. That's kind of highfalutin. But in simple language, he's a hell of a guy, and friendly, and easy to talk to. And he has a reputation for being a great Latin lover, but he happens to be terribly honest. And I am thrilled that you are here. And I am thrilled that Jimmy Coco is here. And I am thrilled, of course, that Geraldine is here. And I hope that Gerard is thrilled that he is here. Okay. What do you think about Burt Lance, Marcello? Have you been following American politics at all? Do you follow it at all?
Politics. No, he does not follow American politics.
All right.
And who
can
blame him?
You know,
yeah.
I'll talk slowly.
Slowly.
I am sorry. All right. We'll talk about things we both care about, and that's you in a little bit. As you know, Burt Lance did not make it. We predicted a great film star and one of, I think it's going to be a thrill for all of us, Marcello Mastroianni, followed by Jimmy Coco, Geraldine Fitzgerald, and Gerard Depardieu to talk about the SST. No, he won't. He's coming from France. That's right. Au revoir, ladies and gentlemen. Jusqu'à la prochaine time avec Marcello Mastroianni. See you in a minute. This is one of the most exciting, talented, glamorous men in the world. He doesn't maybe look so glamorous this morning. He needs to shave because you're in a motion picture.
Yeah.
Bye Bye Monkey.
Bye Bye Monkey.
We're talking to actor Marcello Mastroianni, known to us from such films as La Dolce Vita, 8½, Divorce Italian Style, also Marriage Italian Style,
yes.
Right? And a current film, A Special Day, co-starring Sophia Loren. We talked to her a little bit the other day on the air, and I had not seen the picture, and I did see it. It is a smash. Marcello, you and I had brunch last Sunday at Lucy Jarvis's house. And I was telling you how easy it was to talk with you, rather. And you were telling me that in your country, actors are a little bit different. Tell us about that. We get the impression that Robert Redford here, that Nicholson, that many American actors are cut off from the people. It's different.
Yes, I think so. Perhaps because our country is more little. Perhaps the economical situation is different. And perhaps in a certain way it's easier to live in a little country as Italy. And so we still, to live in life, in reality, we have not this big organization that protect you. I mean about agents, about so many things. I had the impression years ago here in New York that, for example, for a director to talk with an actor is something not so easy. He must pass through an agent and then actors, they have personal screenwriter. Mm-hmm. I don't know, perhaps I make mistake, but I had this impression that here to be a movie star means really to be a movie star.
That's right.
In Italy, it's quiet. It's easier.
Much different.
Perhaps it's not good for us.
No, it's very good for the audience. The films have a spontaneity. This is interesting. You came to town last Saturday. You had not even seen the script for the motion picture, right?
No, I was at sea in Italy, and Marco Ferreri, the director of Bye Bye Monkey, is an old friend to me. I made 4 films with him. And he called me, he said, tomorrow morning, take a plane, come here in New York. I need you in my film. Well, I say, okay. I didn't know what was the film about. And I know just that you have to make a film here. Mm-hmm. But I never asked him about what was
what
the film.
What is this film about you're shooting now? What is
well,
it
about? I think about modern life, about obsession of our society, about everything, about life. And a life that I think becomes more and more dramatic. And so the film is something about this in a way. Ironic, it's a kind of satire, if you want. And that's what I know as a general impression about the film. Also, if are 3 days that I'm working inside, and you ask me how you can work inside. Yes, because I think to know, I know well, I think, the nature and what is the feeling about life of Mr. Ferreri. And so I am completely abandoned. I am very well. He tell me, this gentleman, I think he must be in this way. We talked about for 2 days. And it's difficult to explain. Perhaps I give the impression that we are superficial, but we are.
No. It has a...
We make film as live real.
Right, I understand. Marcello, you've had a couple of very interesting interviews, and one of them was, I thought, in Playboy. And you said this, in my country, we're talking about Italy, I was brought up with the thought of man as a padrone, the pillar of the family. And then you say, I wanted to be a loving, caring, protective man, but now I feel lost. Do you still feel that way?
I think my generation, yes. I changed from this time, because this, I think, is about 10, 12, 13 years ago that I made this interview. Well, I learned something through life. Also, perhaps because in my country, dramatic things happen in a political, in an economical way, and so I had to observe. Before, I was more, I liked to say, I feel lost, I am full of confusion, was typical of my generation. I made a film in this way, it was 8.5.
Mm-hmm. That was your favorite film, was it?
Yes,
that?
Sensitive man, intelligent, but a little lost and with ideas not clear. Yeah. Today, I think I have idea more clear.
So your ideas, you do not feel lost anymore?
No.
What about the notion, you had a very interesting characterization of American women. You say they're very unhappy.
The American
is that true, that you found them very melancholy and very unhappy?
Well,
that's what you said here. Is that a true story?
Why do they use so many pills? Pills.
You talk about, you mean for stimulation or that kind of thing?
No, I think for to be quiet, to sleep, to wake up, to, I don't know. That's always an imagined idea by a foreign people, men, as me. I don't know if it's exact what I thought. Anyway, that's the impression that I had.
Let me spell it out. You say this. So you were asked, how about American women? You say they should retreat, but they don't. You say, I've never seen so many unhappy, melancholy women. They have liberty, but they are desperate. Poor darlings, they're so hungry for romance that two little words in their ears are enough to crumble them before your eyes. American women are beautiful, but a little cold and too perfect. Do you believe that?
A little, yes. I saw this in a cocktail party. Uh-huh. People need to talk. And also without pudor, you say. They tell you everything about them private life. I don't understand why. Through scotch, whiskey.
You mean they just talk?
That means that they need.
But what are they sensing you? They want to tell you, though, Marcello. Why they want to tell you these things?
Because evidently they are quiet and enough tired about here. I came from another country, so ready to tell.
But they sense something. They want to take care of you. In other words, they sense this vulnerability in you, right? And they want to love you. Is that what it is?
Perhaps, but that's.
Do you like this?
Yes, why not? It's not disagreeable.
I wanted to spend. They say you've had, you know, that you have this reputation for being this tremendous lover. Is that true or false?
Listen, the other day we had a little accident just because. Now I can't say again.
No, don't say.
Because I use a word, perhaps. Oh, no, I understand.
Yeah.
Yes, it's very, very cheap, very vulgar.
Right.
I'm very sorry. Sorry, well, anyway, listen. No. In life, we say all the time this word, why here, we can't once. I'm not American, so.
No. You know Frank Sinatra. He's Italian, too.
Yeah.
Frank Sinatra has this reputation for being a great lover.
Yeah.
And so they said, what about it, Frank? And he said, if I had all the love affairs people said I did have, I would be in a jar at a medical school. In other words, I would have killed myself. Is sure. It the same way with you?
But sure. But imagine to have this reputation, if you go with a woman, at least she have to make this during the... that's destroyed a man.
Yes.
You think that we can have this... No, come on. I am a very normal man.
A very normal man.
This is really...
Is it embarrassing for you, though, that a lot of women have great expectations for you, sexually?
No.
Does not embarrass you?
No, that's embarrass me. I understood that you say they have a bigger expectation. You mean
do they expect
admiration?
You to be sexually...
I think so. If yes. We go on to talk about this, but look, my hair, it can be white. Also, this is a little problem. I am not a miracle. I was a miracle.
You were a miracle.
Not before. No.
You were never a miracle.
No.
Oh. Marcello, would it be this is a historical show. And maybe an unfair question, but, and I don't mean this to be cheap. Do you have any idea how many women you've had in your lifetime?
How many I had? Oh, no, not so many. No, really.
Really?
I don't want to say the number because that make complication in my life. It's quiet. Anyway, not so many. I think less than an engineer, our friend there. I'm sure he's better than me, and he had much more women. Because with this idea, who we talk about it before, it's a limit. It's not a... It's not something that help you. No, a few women. I had a big love, yes.
You've had a lot of love. Faye Dunaway, Catherine Deneuve, so many.
Well, now we go all the way to, I think.
These are personal.
Anyway,
yeah. Our special guest this morning is really a great man, Marcello Mastroianni. We're going to talk about a lot of things. We'll get off some silly subjects, and we'll talk to Marcello about courage in his life and Italian films, followed by Jimmy Coco and Geraldine Fitzgerald and Gerard Depardieu. They're all making a new motion picture here in New York. Please stay, Marcello. Stay where you are. These men are not... this is very much the way it is in Italy, like paparazzi. They can stay here. Just stay here during the show. All right. I don't want to just play you cheap. In other words, about the sex thing. So you think that's overdone? That you haven't had that? All right. Now you've had some tremendous love affairs, and one of them that I read about was with Faye Dunaway. And I don't know if I should talk about this, but that was a very big love affair. You were in love with her, and she wanted to marry you, but you would not divorce your wife. Was that what it was?
Well, it's not so simple.
No.
I needed more time, because now we come back our generation.
Right.
For a man as me in Italy, church, education, religious education.
Yeah. It's important.
Made man wrong. So.
Made men right?
Wrong. Not right. Not. We have to make a certain effort to ask for a divorce.
Uh-huh.
We was educated in a bad way.
Right. Now, do you think that Catholicism in Italy made it difficult?
It's negative.
You think it was negative?
Absolutely.
It made it difficult for you to have a happy life, do you think?
Yes.
You do believe?
Yes, because made men full of
guilt.
Guilty and the complication in every way.
Would you have married Faye Dunaway had you been able to do it?
Frankly, I don't believe more in marriage.
You do not believe in modern marriage? But you are married now.
Yes, I still be married, yes.
How long have you been married?
About 27 years.
Could I ask you, do you live with your wife?
Not really.
And is you, she
very
has
your friend.
Yeah, she has your friend, your name.
Yes.
And she's like a sister to you.
No, like a sister. I don't like this word. A good friend.
A good friend.
Yes.
Now, do you have a mistress too? You have a girlfriend now?
Yes, I have a love affair, yes.
Is she here in the United States or is she in Italy?
She's in the United States.
Uh-huh. Now, you also had if I'm saying things I should not say, please tell me, I don't want to embarrass you. But there's a story that Catherine Deneuve, who's also a great French actress, has your child.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yes.
Now, how often do you see the child?
Oh, 3-4 times by year.
Right. Now, what do you think? America's also going through great changes about marriages, you know. What do you think a good marriage should be? Is it possible, in your judgment, today in America or in the world, to have a good marriage?
Well, why not? Perhaps it's possible, but it's very difficult.
Uh-huh.
I mean that, for example, I have a daughter about 25 years old.
You do?
She lives with a young man. She isn't married. She doesn't like. She doesn't ask for marriage, because I think relationship are more
looser, different.
We feel more free,
independent.
Would be necessary that marriage change as an idea, as an idea. Well,
as an institution.
Yeah, if marriage becomes something, I don't know, quite different. Or people have to change and to look at marriage in a different way, with much more respect, the one for each other. Still, be I think marriage is something like, a prison.
Like a prison,
know,
yes.
Something that
a lot of people.
Then
feel.
You feel you are married and you feel sure about her or about you. A little bit that's destroy things.
I understand. Let me ask you a question. This is something that I face in my own life. Let us suppose you're in love with a woman, and you think that, in other words, here's my question. Is it necessary for the woman that you love to be faithful to you? Do you understand my question?
Yes. Oh. I think so.
I think so.
Well, frequently, We are full of illusion. We believe that she is faithful. She isn't. Would be interesting if would be ready to accept that her to make some experience as men usually.
Yes.
They have. They make.
Can you be faithful to? I'm sorry, my child.
No, tell me.
Can you be faithful to a woman?
Generally, yes. But I have to confess that perhaps. It happens, but that's it's not so dramatic. It doesn't change my feeling for my woman.
Right.
For this reason, I said would be very interesting if men too would be ready to accept if she sometimes make another experience.
You think she should, a man should be able to accept woman having the same experience as a man?
It's difficult, but I think it would be good.
It would be good.
I think so.
Women would be the same as men, in other words.
Yeah.
All right, in one of the pictures that I love that you did, Casanova 70,
yes,
was a story about a man, you, who loved his wife. But to keep the marriage alive, he had to make love to her under very dangerous circumstances.
Yes.
He and the wife would check into a building in a hotel, yes, maybe on the 29th floor in adjoining rooms.
Yes.
And then he would walk along the ledge outside the building, yes, to get to her room because, now, I understand that that's why many men take their wives to motels, because there's danger or something.
If they find a room at 29th floor.
Have you ever done that, though, try to get excitement and danger into your love affair?
No, no. Not me, but I made this film really expressly because the idea, the general idea that people have about Italian lover make me laughing. And so with the director, the writer, we made that was good to make a film about an Italian man that in need have a, is in danger to make love.
Right.
That's mean that he's not so big lover.
In other words, I think it was Nietzsche who said to enjoy the true fruitfulness of existence,
exactly,
we must live dangerously. And that's part of why Casanova wanted to make love under unusual circumstances.
Well, I like to show that this image that you have about Italian love, it's absolutely an invention.
Suppose, I'm sorry, Marcello, let us suppose you go to a party and you see a very attractive woman there,
yeah,
and she wants to make love to you because she wants to find out. Do you feel a little bit used? Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
You do.
A little. That's the mistake of the Italian man.
What?
They would like, they need fantasy,
uh-huh,
about love, so they would like to think, I go destroy this fam, this woman. I won't make her life very complicated. If she have an husband, I will destroy everything. They need something...
psychological.
Yeah. If listen, I want to give you an example. When I had some friends, ladies, foreign friends, they said, why in Rome, young men, they said that's always things I would like to make love with you. With that. What we have to do? I'm afraid, sometimes I'm also excited. I always said, tell him, go, let's go, and you will see immediately they disappear. Because you become immediately frightened. It's so simple. It's too simple, too easy.
Your grandfather was very important to you, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was the patron, wasn't he?
Yes.
He was the last generation of men who stood at the center of the family, right?
Yes.
And your mother was, is your mother alive?
Yes, still alive.
And you see her, you sometimes you spend time in her apartment, don't you?
No, 5 minutes. That's all, because she's deaf, and so it's dramatic to have a conversation with her.
It is dramatic. All right, Marcello Mastroianni. What a thrill to talk to you. All right, we'll be back with Marcello Mastroianni, followed by James Coco, who is also of the Italian persuasion, Geraldine Fitzgerald, who I assume is Irish, and Gerard Depardieu, who is French. The Allies, ladies and gentlemen, are on parade on this show. We'll see you after this timeout. I said before that Marcello Mastroianni is in town making a new film called Bye Bye Monkey. His co-stars are talented actor, he certainly is, and recent Obie winner James Coco on my far right there. You speak Italian, don't you?
Yeah. No, I don't speak it very well, but I understand it.
Uh-huh.
Because when I grew up, my parents spoke Italian all the time, but I can understand it.
All right, let me introduce now, pardon me, Jimmy, veteran actress and singer Geraldine Fitzgerald on my left right here, and a man named Gerard Depardieu, who, as Liz Smith said in her column, was a man everybody will be talking about. Como se va, senor aujourd'hui?
Très bien, impeccable.
Which means he speaks fine. You're all here to make this picture. Jimmy, let me ask a question about Italian-Americans before we get to Gerard and Geraldine. He is an Italian, you are an Italian-American. Is there a difference in your judgment?
No, we have the same problems. I think I think any, well, I was brought up in an Italian household, uh-huh. And you do have certain hang-ups. You have religious hang-ups.
Right.
You have an awful lot of guilt. At least Italian Americans have a lot of guilt.
And you, about what?
Oh, all kinds of things.
For example,
almost anything.
Say it, because I've been
eating an extra plate of pasta. I don't know. I mean, you know, anything. I mean, you do carry a lot of guilt around with you, and there is the church, and there is the. We do. I found that when I made a film in Italy, the American actors and the Italian actors were very similar.
Terms of what I'm getting at is this: for example, I've talked to blacks from Africa, mm-hmm. who, for example, might have personality with American blacks. There's something in the culture here that makes them different. Mm-hmm. For example, Israelis are fundamentally different than American Jews. Are Italian Americans different than Italians? In other words. After all, he's the majority in this country. He's free. He's not living as a minority in this country. You are. There's been persecution because you're an Italian here,
yes.
Not because you're a Catholic.
Yes.
There's no persecution in his country.
No.
Could you address this premise?
No.
But you know, it's a valid premise, though, isn't it?
It is a valid premise. There is a difference. There isn't a difference as far as actors are concerned. I think we all have the same problems. I think what Marcello says is right. In Italy or in France, we do have a problem in America, and I think Geraldine will bear me out on this. We do work through agents, and we do work through. And before a director can get to the actor, there is so much red tape involved. I mean, Marco merely called Marcello
director.
Up and said, "Come
yes.
do a movie for
yes.
me," and Marcello said, "Yes." In America, it's a lot different. Half the time, we don't even know the movie has been offered to us, or the part has been offered to us until it's gone through many channels. In my case, Marco Ferreri, whom I admired enormously, I had seen all of his films, had come to see a show I was in, and I didn't even know he was in the audience. And afterwards, we had dinner, and we talked about this picture. So I got it firsthand, and I called my agent and said, I want to do this picture. So, you know, it was like that.
Geraldine, here's a question that I want to ask you, and one of the reasons I wanted Marcello on the show so much this morning is that he's very forthgiving. He's very open. I'm not suggesting that American actors are not. I haven't met all of them. Some of them are. But many of them, I think, are prisoners of fame. You understand what I mean. Him coming on and talking about his life and his loves and being honest and vulnerable is unique. It is really,
yes.
And it's good, you know, that's why he's here. He's not here as a movie actor, he's here as a man. That's why I want him on the show, you know?
Yes, but he's exceptional. Never mind actors or anybody. It's very generous to do what he did to other human beings, and it has great dignity when it's done. It's very good of him. I hardly ever met anybody who'd do what you did. It's wonderful, and we all profit from it. It's grand.
Tell us about your guilt.
Well, yes, I'm an Irish Catholic.
We've had Jewish guilt, Italian guilt.
I have some Irish guilt,
huh?
Yes. Well,
guilt. Well, this is guilt. We talk about, I don't know how often you watch our show, but we really do talk about guilt. It's a drag, isn't it?
Yes, well,
it's terrible.
We have some good guilt in Ireland, if you'd like to come and have some of ours anytime.
What's good guilt?
Well, there's no good guilt.
It's terrible.
It's funny. It's terrible. It wrecks everybody's life. Yes.
Could you give an illustration? Because we're trying to break boundaries here.
Yes, well, in Ireland, for example, love to be approved really has to be something like mother love, transcendental love. That love between people, you know, sexual love is considered rather suspect, not as bad as it used to be in the old days.
Mm-hmm.
Unless children are the outcome of the intercourse, it's not supposed to be encouraged, to put it mildly.
Is that changing in your country?
Yes, it is changing. Of course it is. But I still think, though, that the people of my generation would have a kind of overhang of guilt. I was brought up in a convent, and I know, this is just about any kind of sensuous thing. For the main part of the year, we were not supposed to eat anything we wanted to eat. We were supposed to mortify the flesh. That's what it was called, kill the flesh. And then during Lent, we were supposed, no, I beg, yes, we were not, we were, beg your pardon, back it up. During the year, we had to eat everything on our plate, didn't matter what, even if it was disgusting. Eat it all, because there it was, and that mortified the flesh not to have any preferences. During Lent, you're not supposed to eat anything. So you never knew. And you were always guilty, guilty in Lent, guilty not in Lent.
Gerard,
very
do you
impressive.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Do you understand? I know that you're
approximately.
Approximately. All right, now.
I know you talk about love
flesh.
Yes.
And yes.
Et la diable.
Le diable. Oh.
Yeah, oui.
Now, many of us have not seen you in your. You're in a new Bertolucci film that's supposed to be sensational. It's a 4-hour film. It will be in the New York Film Festival.
Festival.
We're talking this morning about guilt, as it's expressed through the Italians, the Italian.
Guilt, la culpabilité.
Oui.
Yeah. 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 What about French guilt? There are all kinds of guilt in your country, I would imagine. Am I right?
But I don't think the French, there are many guilty, comme on dit, sont pas très, not so much because they don't care about the religion.
Religion is less important.
Yeah. No, they don't care about, for, je sais pas, for me, I don't think I'm very guilt.
You have no guilt?
No. No, I'm sorry.
That's
right. I'm sorry.
You mean you didn't celebrate Yom Kippur yesterday?
Huh?
We'll be back.
He's a baby. He's a baby. Why should he be guilty? He's 20.
I'm not trying to put it on. I don't want him to have it either. I'm just saying he doesn't have it.
You can make everything with your.
We'll be back with Marcello, Jimmy, Geraldine, and Gerard after this time. In fairness to Gerard, and this man is an enormous film star in Italy. I don't mean Italy,
Europe.
In Europe. And well, that's, come on, Italy is part of Europe, right? He's from France. He has a little croissant roll, a little coffee au lait in the morning. And you are the star of this motion picture,
yes.
Goodbye Chimp. Tell us, what is it about? What is this motion picture about?
It's very hard to explain because I never read the script also. We just talked with Marco, and I lose my script all the time.
You lose it?
Yes, I lose also the 1900. The first day I was in Italy, I lose my script because the words make me burn.
Make you?
We m'ennuie.
Bore.
Yeah,
meaningless.
Yeah.
Are you going to shoot today? Are you going to do some of the motion picture today?
Yeah.
Would you do us a favor? Can you, for example, look into that camera there and describe the character or one, the character you play, and just give us a little, some lines? Can you do that? Can you?
Yes.
Go ahead. It would be a thrill for us. Please do it, Gerard.
Yes, he does.
We're going to see the chimp in a minute. Can you do that, Gerard, though? Can you say some of the words?
Some of the words?
Please, right into the camera. It'd be a thrill for
this
us.
This is
you're shooting today on the streets of New York.
Today we should, come on. This is the, come on, Luigi.
Because he brings these derelicts on trips around the city. Marcello is a derelict, I'm a derelict. And we
is there
have
a scene?
Other derelicts, Avon Long.
Is there a scene in which the four of you are present that somehow you can't?
No.
So it would be impossible to have them do it, I suppose, huh?
Yes, it really, it's a very difficult thing to ask, and I have to.
I know. Well, we do things.
I know.
You
do very difficult.
All right, let me ask you a very simple, okay, you talk about guilt. Here's something that I want to, I have all kinds of guilt. You have guilt, we all have guilt. This is unfair to you, but France has not had in this century, a very good war record. Am I right? World War I was not very successful. World War II was not very successful. Indochina was not very successful. Algeria was not very successful. Do you understand what I mean? The French seemed to lose those wars. Does that make the French feel a little guilty?
No, je pense pas. No.
And you haven't had a very good record either.
a war record.
We like to win them in this country. You guys like to, you know, maybe I'm being unfair, but you know, I mean, the Italian military was not real good in World War II, was it?
Military?
In other words, Italy did not do very well in World War II.
Not according to the Italians.
Fortunately.
Fortunately.
Oh, yes. I don't like.
But you don't feel bad about it?
Strong soldier.
Oh, you don't?
Strong general. I hate. Mm. I don't like hero. I prefer someone that. This means that he loves life.
Yeah.
He don't believe in what he's doing.
But what about medals and guns going off and parades? And it's exciting, isn't it?
No.
No
I
good?
I don't think it's good, these.
No good, huh?
No, not
medals,
war.
All these things. You mean these?
Yes.
And hat?
Yes.
Generals?
Yes.
No, I think that's... No. No, well, I hope that's finished one day. That we'll finish.
Serious question. In your country and in your country, we get the impression that the communists may come to power. Do you think that's possible, that Italy will become communist soon?
Why not?
Why not? What do you mean, why not?
It means that evidently this country need to have another kind of ideal, another kind of a government, another kind of a religion, political religion, if you want.
So you think Italy might become communist?
Perhaps. I am not sure. What but about, I'm not worried about.
What about France?
It's the same thing. In France, in Italy, the politics, ideas, the same thing.
If we can do this, we have the monkey. Yeah. You come with me, Marcello. And Joseph is the trainer. Follow me. I'll be back in a second. Joseph, here is the monkey, right? And this is the chimp in the motion picture.
Bye-bye monkey.
Bye-bye monkey. And this, oh, look at that monkey. How does that do that? What kind of a chimp is it?
I don't understand.
Oh, and you don't understand either, right?
He's Italian too.
Oh,
he's born in Italy.
He speaks Italian.
Not Italy.
Only Italian, the chimp.
Yeah.
Now, tell us about the chimp. How old is this chimp?
Eight months.
No, but
his father can talk with you. Gerard.
Come over here a minute, Gerard. Take the microphone.
I am just the uncle of our.
Right?
He is the father.
Gerard, if you would stand on Joseph's right here, tell us about this monkey, can you? This chimp?
Chimps, yeah.
You tell us about the chimp.
Tell him something. Deal with something.
Bella.
Prova a prenderla.
Bella, vieni.
Should we give the chimp a banana? Is the chimp
yes.
A banana?
Yes.
Let's give him the banana, but where's the banana?
In
the mailbox. All right.
Came special delivery.
Here comes the banana. Now, why is the chimp in the picture? What does the chimp symbolize? Hello?
I think a new life, go on. A new life, a young life that still go on in life.
Uh-huh.
Because the film, I think, like to show that our kind of life doesn't work anymore. That's a little symbol.
A little symbol. And the chimp is really the star of the motion picture in many ways, huh?
Yeah.
What does the chimp do, Gerard? What will the chimp do?
He makes baby. He do the baby. He fait l'enfant.
Makes a baby.
Makes a baby.
And becomes a citizen. Her name is Bella.
Bella Lafayette.
Lafayette. Yeah.
Because we declare him in the municipality. And he
gave her name, his name, to her. Mm-hmm. His name is Lafayette in the film. Mm-hmm. So she becomes Bella Lafayette, mm-hmm. Real with the documents.
We'll be back with the chimp and Marcello. Thanks. That's all right. I just want to say in conclusion what a thrill it was to have everyone on the show. Jimmy, you're a very selfless man, you really are, and Gerard and Geraldine, and Marcello, it's a great thrill. You are a hell of a guy, and it's a thrill to meet you and talk to you on television. You're precisely the way you are in films, and that's a real compliment. We all are thrilled that you are here. Monday, these two, Terry and Brooke Shields, you're going to be surprised. They're very nice. This child on the right has posed nude in a new motion picture, and we'll find out why and what her mother has to say about it on Monday. See you next week. We'll be right back.